So the original title of this talk was The Secret Programming Technique That They Don't Want You to Know About. But it's probably more the really useful programming technique that they don't think you should care about anymore, but you should. Because it's the intersection of two really important programming principles. The first is K.I.S.S., keep it simple, stupid. The more straightforward and verbose and simple your code is, the easier it is to understand and debug. The second is D.R.Y., or don't repeat yourself. This is try not to put the same block of code in two or more places, so that way when you need to make a change, you only can change it one place, and then it'll propagate through all the places it's used, and you don't have to worry about a bug showing up over there and fixing it, and then having it show up over here too because you forgot to fix it there. But now things get complicated, right? So you've got a bunch of different screens or a bunch of different models that all have the same kind of functionality in them. But you don't want to repeat the code, so you end up pulling it all into some kind of abstraction, inheritance, or something weird. And that means when you go to debug it because you're trying to troubleshoot it, things have gotten a lot more complicated, and that leads to anything but simple. The answer to this, as far as I'm concerned, is called code generation. Now these days, code generation makes a lot of people think of like GitHub Copilot or AIs spitting out code, but it's actually a much older and much more reliable concept. Because this technique is guaranteed to be useful in a wide range of situations, whereas often the code that's generated the AIs is just sh**. This is the Internet of Bugs. My name is Carl, and I've been a computer professional for 35 years, and I'm on a quixotic crusade to help try to reduce the bug count on the internet. This episode is part of my book club series, but it's also part of a new series about programming techniques that have been lost to time, things that used to be common knowledge, but no one that I work with these days ever seems to have heard of. I just recorded an episode of a podcast called Book Overflow. It's here on YouTube as well as other places. It's a great podcast and you should check it out. Links below both to the podcast itself and to the particular episode that I was in. In prep for that podcast, I was going through some books that I was going to be recommending and I noticed a weird thing. So one of my favorite chapters in this book, The Pragmatic Programmer, which is a book that I've had for a long, long time and really cared about and never recommended before, was removed for this book, which is the 20th anniversary edition. And that chapter that was removed was on code generators, which is a thing that I still use quite a bit, but it's fallen out of favor. And I've noticed that a lot of the folks that I work with now have never used it and don't really understand how it works. Part of that's because in one of the more common ways that we used to use it, we don't need it anymore. So back in the before times, code was a lot more verbose. There was a ton of what we call boilerplate code, code that has to be there in order for things to work. It's often repeated over and over. Modern languages have gone a long way towards eliminating the need for a lot of that boilerplate that we used to have everywhere. Go look up what we used to have to do in the late 90s for getters and setters in Java 1.2 and compare that to the equivalent code in current Kotlin. You go from, 10 or 20 lines to one. In addition, back then we didn't have editors with autocomplete like we do now. And I'm not even talking about Copilot, right? I'm just talking about the normalish autocomplete that started up in like the 2005-ishes that just would give you a list of things that started with that you could pick from. So we did things the hard way. And what we had to do is we wrote these, well, we didn't have to, but what we did is we wrote these scripts, usually in a text manipulation language like Perl or something. And they would generate all that boilerplate for us. So we would say, this is the variable that I want, and then it would spit out the getter and the setter and all that stuff, and we wouldn't have to actually type all that code in ourselves, which was saved us a bunch of time. Now you don't need to do it for that, but that doesn't mean that you should sleep on code generation because it's way more useful than just for getters and setters. It's still around some. It's part of how Rails got so popular so fast by generating a bunch of boilerplate for you. Express.js has a similar express generator that like will create views and models and that kind of thing. There are other kinds of things too. And these days, a lot of that gets done by, either AI or your editor IDE. There are a lot of things where you start to type a function and it like fills stuff out for you. A lot of times though, those fail the don't repeat yourself test because it spits out the boilerplate. And then over here, it spits out the same boilerplate. And over there, it spits out the same boilerplate. And then if you find out there's a different way you wanted to do it, you have to go change it everywhere. There's a better way, and it's really worth learning. Let me prove it to you. So this is an article from 2001 from Paul Graham, who's now of Y Combinator fame, about the relative strength of various programming language features. So he talks about how powerful macros in Lisp are. and how his 90s startup stayed far ahead of his competitors by making use of list macros and making lots of use of them. Now, he's right about the power of macros, but there are two hurdles. One is that when list macros go wrong, or really when any macros go wrong, but especially the Lisp ones, and they do go wrong, they're a nightmare to debug because the code that's actually running in memory, the runtime state, doesn't necessarily exist in the code base at all. You get these, you know, it's like, okay, I get a stack trace. The code from the stack trace doesn't appear anywhere in my project. I can grep for it. It's just not there because it got constructed on the fly. Who knows what all is going on? The second issue is that the Lisp ecosystem lacks a lot of the kinds of library and integration support that 21st century programmers are used to. So you end up having to write a bunch more code yourself. And this was true back then, but back then there was a lot fewer libraries that you could just grab off the shelf. These days, schedules are tight enough that you end up having to grab a bunch of open source modules. Please, hopefully, get reliable ones, but that's a concept for another video. Enter code generation. So you get almost all the power of Lisp macros, but you can program in the language of your choice, and then understanding and debugging is actually easier because there's no weird abstractions. The code is just right there laid out, so as you're stepping through it, you know exactly what it does. Now, I'm not going to get too into the details here. YouTube's analytics tells me that as soon as I put a code listing on the screen, half of you stop watching immediately. So if deep dives into that kind of thing are something you'd really want, leave a comment. And if there are enough of you, I'll see if I can figure out something, I don't know, maybe another channel or something where I can give you the code you want without the YouTube algorithm cutting my audience way down because it thinks that everybody hates me. But the concept is simple, right? Even without having to show you a bunch of code. Anytime you find yourself repeating code in a bunch of different places, and you have this tendency by don't repeat yourself to want to refactor and eliminate all that duplication by relying on something like class inheritance or abusing the command pattern or using some obfuscating language feature like Python decorators or God forbid some Spring or Hibernate thing that just makes things harder to read and harder to understand and harder to debug. Instead, consider writing a template file with most of the code that's duplicated, and then create some way to list all the different variants, the different model variables or the different screen names, and then put that like in a config file or something, and then have part of your early build process run a search and replace text script that creates one of those variants for each one of those things. Those end up landing in your code tree. You can check them in or not, or you can generate them every time or have them check in, whichever. But when the code's actually running and you're trying to figure out what it does, it's actual full-blown all there code that it's really easy to read and step through, but you don't have to worry about a change getting lost because all you have to do is change the template and then it'll spit out all new stuff. You make that change in one place and then in all the different places it's used, it's all up to the newest standard. If you want more information on how to do this, you've got several choices. One of them is you find the old version of this Pragmatic Programmer book. It's got a whole chapter on code generation, and then it's got a chapter on text manipulation languages, and it's got a bunch of stuff in there on code generation that also got taken out for the 20th anniversary edition. Another option is to grab this book, which is called Code Generation in Action by Jack Herrington. It's a great book. It's way more in-depth than you probably need, but once you get that tool in your tool belt, it turns out there are lots and lots of different places that it can be applied. I've used it with great success a lot of places, and a lot of people I just leave dumbfounded because it's something that they've never heard of. There are also some open source libraries that I've heard of. One of them is called Yellowcode, and one of them is called Telesis. I'll put links to them both in the bottom. Now, notice, I've never used either of these. Every time I do this, I roll my own. But these will give you an idea of how things are supposed to be used. They'll give you some good examples. So you'll be able to figure it out. If you want to use them, if they work for you, that's great. Like I said, don't tie yourself to one of those specifically because I told you to, because I've never used either of those. But I've looked enough at their documentation stuff to know that they understand how it's supposed to be used. So you can use that and then either use them or roll your own, up to you. But mainly I want you to take away from this that you can have, if you choose to accept it, a new, really powerful tool in your toolbox. It's incredibly useful and it will give you the vast majority of the functionality of macros or object inheritance or these weird language macro features without having to take all the consequences of the code being so concise and so abstracted and not being able to step through things and getting down into a spot where it's like spitting assembler out at you because there's no actual code in your code base that's doing what this thing is doing right now. It's so much easier to read. It's so much more straightforward, but it's still incredibly powerful. And that means fewer bugs, which is good because the internet already has way too many bugs already. Let's be careful out there. Till next time.